What if I told you that you have everything you need to feel well, to find gratitude and joy in your days? What if all it takes is intention, a desire to learn, and the will to practice a few new ideas? Hi, I'm Kat Hill, and I'm honored to be here today to talk to you about how you can change your brain. Training your brain is the practice of teaching yourself to think certain things. How do you define yourself? How do you feel about having Parkinson's disease? How do you focus your thoughts? We have learned that human brains are plastic, meaning they are pliable and can change over time. We no longer believe that you can't teach an old dog or a middle-aged woman with Parkinson's disease new tricks. Our brains will continue to change until we die. An adult human being can have over 60,000 thoughts in a single day. Over 60,000, that's a huge amount. We all know that we'll experience random thoughts from time to time, sad thoughts, happy thoughts, scary thoughts, funny thoughts. But for the most part, we can control the way that we think or the way that we point our thoughts. Thoughts and the emotions that we attach to them, or feelings, are powerful. The thoughts that we lay down in our brains lay pathways down. These, when repeated, lay deeper and deeper grooves over time, making them easier to remember and easier to return to. Think about the first time you rode a bicycle or learned a new instrument. It was very difficult, but the more you practiced it, the easier it got. The easier it was to jump back on that bike. Makes sense, right? As we continue to have thoughts, there are also a limited amount of space in our brain to have those pathways lie down. If you think about a complicated highway system with lots of cars going in lanes, if we fill those lanes with positive messages, uplifting things, thoughts about joy and gratitude and ability, there's simply no other space for sad or unhappy thoughts, fearful thoughts. So things like choosing to say, I am strong, I am capable, I've got this, I can find joy in my days, I'm grateful. It's one choice. You can fill your highway with those things. The other choice is to spend time in what I call rabbit hole thinking. Thinking about fear, disease, disability, despair, distress. It's a choice. When we all are diagnosed, of course there's a time of grieving and loss and sadness and fear. And then we work through that. We move towards acceptance. And it's in acceptance where we learn that we have choices. As a nurse practitioner and nurse midwife, I spent my pre-Parkinson's life delivering babies. I saw patients in clinic and then attended them at births at a busy inner city hospital. And I had an opportunity to study and learn a lot about fear, a lot about pain, a lot about education, a lot about empowerment. And even pain that results in something wonderful like the birth of a child is still painful. What I was learning as I practiced for over a decade was that women that chose to engage with me in their prenatal care, ask questions, were curious, both they and their families gained knowledge. And that knowledge seemed to decrease the fear that they experienced. There's a lot of literature that supports this. We know that people that feel empowered and knowledgeable experience less fear. There's something called the fear-pain-tension cycle. If you picture a triangle with each corner being one of fear, one of pain, and one of tension, the studies have indicated that if we can impact one of those corners or maybe two of those corners, people may feel less pain and experience less fear. And I certainly noticed that in my practice as a midwife. Those women that went through childbirth courses or even actively engaged in their care, brought in questions that they had, studied outside of the office, took time with their partner and their families to learn about the experience, seemed to cope better in labor. Doesn't mean that they didn't experience pain, but their perception of what was happening was less stressful, less fearful. They carried less tension in their bodies. I also learned that these women, if they had an unexpected outcome, let's say they had a cesarean delivery when they really hadn't wanted one, or they had a baby that spent time in the hospital after birth, those families that had prepared ahead of time seemed to fare better after birth. Now you might be asking yourself, what do these questions or what are these stories about childbirth have to do with me and my life with Parkinson's? Well, what I'd like to pose is that our brains are all the same. Circumstances may be different. And if you choose to focus on the things that you can do, learn about the things, learn about your experience, put in your mind grateful and joyful thoughts, the more resilient you'll be, the better you'll be able to cope with what comes ahead. It's possible to have both chronic illness or Parkinson's disease and be well. Here's a little about my story. I was diagnosed with young onset Parkinson's at the age of 48, almost 6 years ago. I left the career I loved of delivering babies, had delivered a few over 800, and I was eagerly waiting my 1,000th delivery. Instead, I left to focus on my health and spend time to learn more about how to take care of my own self. I grieved. I was sad. It was not what I had planned for my life. I was scared. I needed to find out information. Does that sound familiar? But once I laid on the couch for a while and got through my grief, I realized I had a choice and I didn't want to be defined by any disease. So I got up off the couch and decided to start researching some ways to feel better. And I read an article about practicing gratitude. It sounded somewhat easy. So I started every day to write down three things that I was grateful for. Just three, not a sentence, not a paragraph, just three things listed on a piece of, I put it on my calendar actually. It might be, I'm grateful that the electricity turned on today. I'm grateful for dinner with a family. I'm grateful that my son got himself to school. It would be things like that. But on Wednesdays, I was grateful for garbage pickup. I don't know if you've ever lived anywhere that doesn't pick up curbside garbage, but I have up in the mountains. And we had to haul our own garbage in my little hatchback Honda Civic. And in the summertime, it was hot and smelly and quite a chore. So every Wednesday, I'm grateful for the group that comes and picks up my garbage cans. And what I noticed as I started this gratitude practice, within a matter of weeks, I was noticing that instead of focusing on my own body, on how new it was to have Parkinson's, how uncomfortable it felt not to be at work, I was focusing on things that made me happy. Throughout the day, I was noticing things because I knew I had to be accountable to write those things on my calendar, and I felt better. I was feeling lighter. I was feeling happier. I was finding more joys in my day. I was less worried about the chipping paint in the stairwell and the dirty laundry that I needed to do and focused more on things that I felt grateful for. And I started to focus things on outside my own body. I started looking at research, reading studies. And I also knew I had to fill up my time with something else because I wasn't working outside the home. I decided I would challenge myself to learn something new, so I took a watercolor class. I was never an artist, and it was something that I knew I would challenge my brain with. I took a sketchbook journaling class, which was wonderful, that when we used watercolor. What I noticed over time was that as I was learning to sketch and I was focusing on what I was sketching in my sketchbook, I couldn't be worried about the tremor I was having or what time to take my meds or what's ahead for me with Parkinson's disease. I was focused and in the moment, being mindful about what this rosebud looked like and how I could make it look similar on my paper. I also learned while watercoloring about surrender. You cannot control always water and color on a page, sort of like you can't control Parkinson's. But I enjoyed the process, and I also knew that I chose a process where I could be still because I wanted to learn something that might help me as I changed how I was in the world. Our family takes trips and hikes and camps, and we're active, especially when we're not in a pandemic. During these times, I realized that I might need to change how I was doing things. I might be more tired. I might not have the energy to do the up and all the way back trek. But sketching and taking my sketchbook with me allowed me to sit down and be in a place, be mindful, enjoy the experience, and allow myself more energy for the rest of my day. My family has caught on. My husband now sketchbook journals with me sometimes, but they also are comfortable going ahead and doing their thing. It allowed me to look at my abilities new ways instead of focusing on what I couldn't do, which was the rest of the hike. Learning new things helps our brains grow. And like we talked about, learning how to lay new pathways down. And I'm not trying to tell you that you can think away Parkinson's disease. I wish it were the case. But I am saying that you can choose how you change your brain and what you choose to focus on. So I hope you'll think about trying it. I'm Kat Hill, and I thank you so much for your attention today. Enjoy the rest of the day.